This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Polished. College, Class, and the Burdens of Social Mobility by Melissa Osborne. Published by the University of Chicago Press. For Osbornia. Introduction. I first met Morgan, an outgoing young woman, in the spring of 2017 when she was a first-year student at East College. A first-generation student from a working-class family, Morgan was attending East on a full scholarship that was part of a financial aid program that the college launched in 2012 for students from low-income families. Morgan had grown up in Southern California in a multiracial household. Her father was a mechanic by trade and a first-generation American who had emigrated from Mexico in his teenage years. Her mother worked part-time at the local elementary school and raised Morgan and her three younger brothers while taking night classes in office management at the local community college. In our first interview, Morgan was struggling with being nearly 3,000 miles away from home for the first time and missed her family a great deal, a common experience I came to see in most of the students I interviewed. She wished she had been able to see her family during winter break, but her stipend from East was barely enough to cover the essentials, let alone the $500 it would cost to fly home. When we talked, Morgan spent a lot of time describing that she felt out of place as a first-generation student at East, but repeatedly emphasized that she was grateful for the opportunities afforded by attending such a prestigious school. She detailed her coursework and how she was faring in her major, and then laid out her 10-year plan that detailed her path from East to medical school to opening a children's clinic in the low-income neighborhood she grew up in, a dream she shared with her parents. As Morgan explained it, for her and her family, East was more than a school. It was an opportunity at mobility and a chance to change her life and the lives of her family and surrounding community. A year later, I waited for Morgan outside a library at East on a warm spring day. The area was bustling with activity. There were food trucks parked nearby with lines so long they intersected the main walkway. Hurried students dodged and zigzagged through the lines in order to enter the library. There was a small stage set up in the middle of the courtyard, and the voices of two young women reading a collaborative poem punctuated the low buzz of conversations as people enjoyed their lunches in the spring sunshine. After scanning the crowd for a few minutes, I noticed Morgan come rushing through the iron gateway that separated one of East's residential quads and the courtyard space near the library. She was wearing a t-shirt emblazoned with her school's name, and when she reached me, she gave me an unexpected hug and said, "It is so great to see you." I smiled at her and asked her how she was doing. We started to walk across campus, and she let out a heavy sigh, telling me that she was stressing about her finals and that some drama at home was getting in the way of really focusing on her work. As we wound our way across the beautifully manicured campus full of old shade trees and stately historical buildings, she went into detail about how her uncle had borrowed money from her parents to pay for her grandmother's diabetes equipment, but had blown it on a weekend out with his friends instead. Her little brother had called her in a panic over a particularly bad argument between her dad and uncle, and now her aunt was asking her for money to cover the loss. It was a beautiful day, so we decided to walk the mile down a major artery of the city to a coffee shop. As we walked, Morgan continued laying out the events that had transpired in her family over the last few weeks. I interjected comments or questions here and there, but mostly listened intently as our scenery slowly began to change from the dignified architecture and high-end eateries that immediately surrounded East's campus to the more worn buildings that housed fast food restaurants, resale shops, and check cashing stations down the road between East and another college campus nearby. A man on the street asked us for change as we were waiting for the stoplight, and he offered us a snack from the bag hanging off his shoulder, bulging with convenience store sandwich triangles. Morgan chuckled as we walked away and wistfully said that this was her favorite area in the city. When asked why, she took a moment to pensively look into the sky and said, "I think it's because this is where East begins to blur into reality. When I walk down this way, I start to feel more like myself for a minute." She went on to explain that that area reminded her of the working-class area she had grown up in Southern California. Coming to this part of town in her first year had helped with her feelings of homesickness, but now in her second year, she found that her relationship with the space had become more complicated. She said, "At some point this year I realized that maybe I feel more at home here, but the people here see me as an outsider, as someone that belongs at East. And East is all, you belong. We will help you belong, but that doesn't really cut it for me. It's harder than I realized." For Morgan, the stark stratification between East College and its surrounding low-income neighborhoods became a way for her to talk through her ideas and feelings around the transformations in identity that she was experiencing as a socially mobile first-generation college student. The way she described her discomfort with both spaces aligned with many of the students I talked to in my research, and resonated with my own experience as a first-generation student from a working-class background who had attended undergraduate and graduate school at selective colleges. Now, as a researcher, I had walked this route a number of times, going between interviews with students at the two campuses that bookend this strip of road. And while I now had the educational credentials and social and cultural capital to fit in at East College, I remained uncomfortable within its ivied gates. Like Morgan, I too preferred the space between, even as my cultivated university habitus pushed me further away from corner stores and discount shops. As I will detail in the chapters of this book, this sense of being stuck between two worlds is what it feels like to be a first-generation student on a selective college campus for many students. A precarious in-betweenness surrounds much of the first-generation experience. From the moment they arrive on campus, these students feel like outsiders in the elite spaces of the university that often are drastically different from their home communities. As they try to find a place to belong on campus, they can feel pressures to change in ways that produce tensions and ruptures within their families and home communities. And while many colleges try to mainstream first-generation students by offering resources to combat deficits in skills and capital, such programs that are designed to level the playing field often miss the mark of providing the intensive support needed to navigate the unexpected facets of social mobility. Instead of thriving on these campuses that offer the most aid, resources, and support, many first-generation students struggle to navigate the process of becoming socially mobile as a first-generation student, a process that I will show is designed to fundamentally change them in the pursuit of economic mobility. Considering higher education's orientation toward first-generation students. First-generation and low-income student enrollment at four-year colleges and universities in the United States has steadily increased over the last two decades. This demographic shift comes in some part from institutional initiatives that seek to reduce structural barriers to college access, such as targeted admissions recruitment, eliminating SAT-ACT requirements and offering grant-based scholarships instead of loans. Such initiatives draw from a large body of academic research that positions social mobility through higher education as the most promising pathway toward achieving more for families with less. In this framework, high-achieving students from resource-deprived high schools are diamonds in the rough, who, with enough polish from an elite institution, have the potential to become the bright and brilliant leaders of tomorrow. They are excavated out of their home communities by admissions officers and scholarship organizations who deposit them at the gates of higher education with the hope and promise of not just an education, but also a different life. Selective colleges and universities have made particularly large commitments toward increasing access to these pathways of mobility via education as a means for securing a share of high-achieving first-generation applicants. A population that now makes up a diversity category, perhaps as coveted as the one students of color became in the late 1990s and early 2000s. A number of recent authors have critiqued efforts that focus primarily on getting students into college without investing significant resources into adequately supporting students once they arrive on campus. These critiques leverage the well-documented and meaningful disparities in experience and outcomes that have been identified between low-income and first-generation students and their more affluent counterparts across academic, social, cultural, and economic aspects of their education. For instance, regardless of high school training, most first-generation and low-income students report feeling underprepared academically and socially. This feeling can give rise to substantial internal conflicts for socially mobile students and have dramatic negative impacts on their pathways through college as well as on the likelihood of degree completion. Students' ability to adjust and conform to the social contexts of higher education have a direct impact on their ability to achieve academic and social success. At many campuses, the institutional expectations and practices reflect the white middle and upper middle class normative order, and students from racial minorities and low SES, socioeconomic status backgrounds, face a distinct disadvantage in these environments. In addition, personal and family obligations can heighten the precarity of low-income and first-generation students and compromise degree completion. Low-income and first-generation students often describe a feeling of mismatch between the working-class cultural capital they come to college with and the upper-class capital that is normative and expected in higher education environments. This mismatch leads some students to manage their identities through suppressing their working-class backgrounds and habitus, while others construct morally based narratives that justify and exalt their class position relative to their more affluent peers. These students produce symbolic boundaries between themselves and higher SES students, and many develop identity ambivalence toward their experiences. Low SES students not only gain academic knowledge and skills during college, they develop cultural and social capital, and their class behaviors and presentation of self or habitus often begin to transform during college. Although there are surely some students who flourish in these circumstances, research points to this as a time of struggle and tension. For many, the dramatic changes in class position that social mobility via higher education produces result in a crisis of identity that often leads to familial tension, the erasure of working-class identities, and increased prevalence of attrition. Many selective colleges and universities have invested in programming and resources designed to improve the experiences and outcomes of first-generation students. These programs generally emphasize the critical value of transmitting economic, social, and cultural capital to first-generation students as a way to ensure success in college and beyond. And campus initiatives are designed to bring low-income and first-generation students up to speed with their more affluent peers by offering economic, academic, and social resources. These programs seek to reduce the well-documented disparities between these students and their more affluent continuing generation peers, with the long-term goal of stimulating individual upward mobility under the logic that, with enough first-generation students in these academic pipelines, the negative impacts of intergenerational poverty in marginalized communities will decrease in the long run. Colleges have tried to close the gap in economic capital that many low SES students face by increasing grants and scholarships, establishing no-barrier funding structures, instituting food pantries, and developing stipend programs that specifically target low-income and first-generation students. Many schools have worked to reduce barriers around accessing valuable social capital by developing mentoring programs, fostering connections in alumni networks, and providing internships at elite employers across industries. Finally, many universities have invested substantial resources in developing programming around the accumulation of cultural capital and now provide a robust array of workshops on topics like networking, office hours, imposter syndrome, budgeting, and dressing for professional jobs and interviews, as well as opportunities like bridge programs, dedicated academic support staff, guided cultural outings, and specialized orientation programming designed to acclimate first-generation students to college. And while not all schools offer the same programming and resources, it is generally the case that more selective or elite schools offer the most financial aid, have the most valuable networks of alumni, and provide the most programming and resources for students while they are on campus. These interventions have contributed to significant improvements in low-income and first-generation students' outcomes, experience, and retention. And for the most part, schools that are able to provide the most in terms of funding, resources, and support boast the highest outcomes and completion rates for their low-income and first-generation students. It is still important to note, however, that even at the schools with the most resources and support, first-generation and low-income students often continue to report lower levels of campus engagement, higher levels of reported stress and anxiety, lower average GPAs, longer degree completion times, and higher rates of attrition than their more affluent continuing generation peers. This enduring set of inequalities between low-income first-generation students and their peers raises questions around what these programs that focus on capital accumulation might be missing, and how gaps between programming and students' unmet needs may be sustaining these inequalities. This book takes up the question of why, with more resources than ever before, do we still see first-generation and low-income students struggling? To make sense of this gap, this book looks at the experience of being a first-generation student in this new era of significant institutional access, support, and attention. An era that has, in many ways, fundamentally reshaped what it means to be a first-generation college student. These initiatives not only give students access to the valuable knowledge, skills, and experiences they need to navigate college more seamlessly, they transform them into integrated members of their campus communities and, for many students, ultimately produce lasting social mobility. Yet, as I show, these institutional initiatives can have unexpected personal costs for students. Drawing on participant observation and in-depth, longitudinal interviews with 150 first-generation and low-income students at 18 selective colleges and universities across the United States, the research outlined in this book reveals the unintended consequences of these institutional strategies for attracting greater numbers of low-income and first-generation college students to selective campuses. I argue that the same institutional support that gives these students what they need to succeed in college also changes them in ways that they and their families often cannot anticipate. In order to fully take advantage of the opportunities set before them, they are faced with difficult choices that can put their changing identities and beliefs at odds with the expectations of their peers and families. The student experiences detailed throughout the chapters of this book demonstrate that the full impact of trying to support and reshape first-generation students into elites is fundamentally misunderstood by selective colleges. Even with a level playing field, the unexpected challenges associated with jumping the economic ladder can become too much for many students as they try to navigate their precarious positions as socially mobile college students. In many ways, the work that selective colleges and universities do to provide first-generation students with valuable social and cultural capital pushes these students to conform to the normative and elite culture on campus in the name of social mobility. This work aids students in the process of becoming part of their campus communities and provides them with invaluable resources and access to elite networks. This work, however, also fundamentally reshapes how these students understand their identities, beliefs, and positionalities in ways that many of them are not prepared to navigate, especially without the support of a community that has the experience and knowledge to guide them through it. While many selective colleges successfully produce upward mobility for first-generation students, this often comes at an unexpected and major social and psychological cost, a cost that most often goes unnoticed and unaddressed across campuses nationwide. By asserting the importance and in many ways, the superior quality of the capital these students gain during college, selective universities are also reshaping the ways that first-generation students frame the communities they came to college from, and the capital they bring with them, as undesirable and inferior. And while students often are excited for the support, they often face unexpected and unintended social and emotional consequences as they go through this refinement process. As I show, undergoing rapid social mobility during college can generate intense periods of emotional distress and self-doubt for students, as well as social isolation from their peers, families, and home communities, all while students are maintaining full course loads and high grade point averages that are a necessary condition for continued institutional support. The majority of low-income first-generation students and their families cannot anticipate the realities of becoming socially mobile during college, and the unexpected changes and effects that arise as part of this process often lead to significant conflicts and crises. The experiences of students contained in the chapters of this book provide a window into how the unexpected consequences of this process impact student outcomes and experiences, and in some cases, prompt many students to reconsider their college choices and begin to fundamentally question the non-financial costs associated with social mobility and selective educational spaces. The tension between staying in college and staying connected to families affects students' emotional well-being and their academic outcomes at school, leading them to question what are the social and emotional costs of being the target of a social mobility initiative. This book answers this question, highlighting the often unanticipated trade-offs students face as they navigate a selective university setting. As high school seniors, first-generation students look forward to growing and developing academically in college. They are grateful for the opportunity to pursue a college degree, and they feel the same excitement and anticipation about starting college as their more affluent peers. Yet, the complexities of navigating college and social mobility as a first-generation college student often create an unintended burden for students, a double bind or a sense of being stuck between two worlds. From the moment they arrive on campus, many of these students feel like outsiders in the elite spaces of the university that often are drastically different from their home communities. As they search for a place to belong on campus, they can feel pressure to change in ways that produce tensions and ruptures within their families and home communities. Their ability to be a student in these elite settings demonstrates their dedication and commitment to social mobility, often motivated by their desire to be able to give back to their families and lower-resourced communities. Yet, as they progress in college, they must balance the personal and social transformations that college can bring with their histories and ties to home. Unlike their classmates from more privileged backgrounds, these students feel competing pressures to buy in to the elite educational context without selling out in the eyes of their home communities. The student experiences throughout this book highlight that many college campuses are missing a key component that can ease such a transformation in other settings, namely the intensive work of supporting individuals through change and stewarding them into their new identities and roles. When students turn to their colleges and universities for direct support and help with contextualizing and navigating their experiences, they are often left empty-handed, referred to inadequate and inaccessible campus mental health services, or directed toward additional programming designed to assist them in developing even further capital. This gap between the support students need to understand and unpack the experience of becoming socially mobile and the programming and support available on selective college campuses produces further challenges, and in many cases lends to increased feelings of alienation and the development of anger and resentment around the first-generation experience. This book shows that in many ways, selective colleges provide all the resources that first-generation students need to build extensive amounts of capital, but they do not provide students the direct support they need to navigate the complicated process of change that they experience as a result. And while some students are able to develop strategies and build informal peer support teams in order to make it through to graduation, others struggle to keep up this extended balancing act. These students are faced with a difficult choice that they should not have to make: college and mobility or community and authenticity. Reimagining and reframing mobility. A consideration of how social mobility is approached academically and understood more broadly is helpful for examining emergent questions around why inequalities in student experiences and outcomes may continue to persist in the face of robust interventions. Academic research and popular cultural imaginaries most often frame social mobility in almost exclusively economic terms. This is due, at least in some part, to the fact that economists have dominated this area of research with studies on income mobility. Social mobility is most broadly understood as a process in which an individual moves up in socioeconomic status, advancing from one income quartile to another, or from a lower salary to a higher one. And while aspects such as occupation and social status are important to this process, the goal of economic gain is still often at the core of how upward mobility is conceptually understood. Rooted in this economic understanding of social mobility is the notion that mobility is something to achieve. It is seen as an end goal to be reached and not a process that is experienced. In this framework, economic mobility has finite boundaries that are measured incrementally in terms of income or wealth and divided and grouped into an orderly set of linear categories like quartiles. The points of division between income levels are often interpreted visually as rungs on a ladder, and the metaphor of climbing the ladder has become central to the way Americans describe working towards social mobility. Higher education has long been seen as the primary vehicle for climbing the ladder and achieving the kind of upward mobility that is central to the American dream. And while sociologists have demonstrated that this vision of higher education does not accurately reflect the opportunity structure it provides for the majority of students, it persists as the dominant cultural frame for preparing and recruiting K-12 students for a college trajectory. This is particularly true for students from underrepresented backgrounds. Students from these backgrounds, who are often unlikely to have unfettered access to social mobility via higher education, are also the most widely featured in the popular press and media as feel-good examples of how hard work, determination, and intelligence can overcome adversity and lead to extreme mobility. The stories of the most disadvantaged students in the United States who have made their way from deep poverty to schools like Harvard University have become our modern-day Horatio Alger story. If these students can jump the ladder in such a spectacular fashion, then surely the American dream must be thriving. What isn't as often discussed in popular media, however, is that the deeply stratified class structure in the United States is what often prevents the poorest students from taking an incremental approach toward climbing the ladder. Barriers around resources, education, and employment abound for the lowest income students in the country, and although exceptional, the highly publicized path of those that skyrocket to the top of the ladder via excellence is often considered the most feasible path. Social scientists have produced a robust perspective of how low-income first-generation students experience their time at selective and highly selective colleges and universities. And while much of this work has highlighted how this experience can produce a sense of division between these students and their more affluent continuing generation peers, we know far less about what happens as these students become more like their peers and less like the families and communities they are coming to college from. This gap in the larger picture of the first-generation student experience is due, at least in some part, to the academic and popular framing of social mobility as an economic goal instead of a social process. This dominant perspective of social mobility misses how individuals and their communities frame and experience the process of becoming socially mobile as they embark on and navigate their college careers. By thinking solely in economic terms, the ways that college acts as a transformative process to change individual and community perspectives, beliefs, and behaviors are often overlooked. In doing so, the ways in which the competing demands that arise out of being situated within and between two social spaces reproduce inequality for first-generation students have been underinterpreted. And while the first-generation and low-income students with experiences that cement them as the poster children for social mobility are exceedingly rare, understanding their experiences as they navigate the murky waters of extreme social mobility is deeply valuable for understanding how social mobility impacts individuals more broadly. This book's robust qualitative approach richly details these students' experiences and provides the data needed to re-examine the unintended consequences and outcomes of social mobility initiatives on campuses across America. When these students' trajectories through college are evaluated in traditional academic or institutional research, the focus is on graduation outcomes, career placement, and whether or not mobility was achieved. What this static focus on outcomes misses, however, is what happens to individuals and their communities as they navigate the process of social mobility. This book highlights how this institutional focus on outcomes is reflected in the messaging that many students receive from their colleges and universities. Social mobility and a college degree should be your focus, no matter how painful or alienating the process of getting there may be. For many students, it is the process of pursuing social mobility, not the potential outcome that defines their college experience. The study. This study focuses on the experiences of 150 socially mobile, low-income students, the majority of which are the first in their families to attend college. I spent time with and interviewed these students from 2016 to 2021 while they were attending 18 unique, selective and highly selective private colleges in Illinois, Massachusetts, Oregon, and Texas. This cohort of colleges includes 9 liberal arts colleges and 9 research universities, with the largest undergraduate population being approximately 16,000 students and the smallest being approximately 1,300 students. I assign pseudonyms to the colleges and universities and group them by region when referenced directly, producing 4 composite schools: East College, Midwest College, South College, and West College. I group campuses this way to help protect the privacy of the students in this study. I selected private colleges and universities because, in general, they have the most resources available to support low-income first-generation students in terms of financial aid, academic support, and programmatic support. And yet they still see the similar gaps in performance, outcomes, and experience between their low-income first-generation and non-low-income first-generation students that have been documented at less selective and public institutions. This paradox, or puzzle, is largely what brought me to this project in the first place. And focusing on these highly selective private institutions seemed like the best way to begin understanding why. I found participants for this study in 3 ways: by emailing recipients and applicants of the Jack Kent Cook College Scholarship, by contacting first-generation student groups and organizations on each of the campuses in the study, and through the social networks of students already participating in the study. All of the students who participated in the study were considered low-income by their colleges and universities, with the majority of students having families with annual adjusted gross incomes of $30,000 or less. 88% of students identified as first generation, with neither parent completing a bachelor's degree. I decided that including low-income students, who were both first generation and not first generation, was an important part of the story I wanted to tell with this project. There are debates around what it is about a student's parents, such as their economic versus cultural capital, that matter the most for students' college outcomes and experiences, and I hoped that this project could bring further data to the table. What I found is that a parent's ability to understand, connect, and recognize touchstones of the college experience matters. And that this element, having parents with the ability to anticipate and frame at least some aspects of a child's college experience, becomes a significant advantage that first-generation students most often do not have. Of the 150 students I spent time with and talked to, I interviewed 100 of them in person once during their college career. The remaining 50, who were nearly all first-year students at the time of our first interview, agreed to participate in a series of longitudinal in-person and virtual interviews. I had the opportunity to re-interview these students at multiple points throughout their college careers and, for some, into their post-grad lives. When I could not talk to students in person because of scheduling or a global pandemic, I conducted interviews online or had students answer long-form qualitative survey questions. I decided to incorporate a longitudinal approach toward my interviews with students because I thought this would be the best way of capturing how students change and experience college over time. The questions I had coming into this project necessitated that I talk to students at different points in their college careers to see how their perspectives were changing, and to understand when and how important elements of social mobility emerge for these students during college. Because I started this project without knowing for certain that I would be able to recruit a significant number of students to participate in a longitudinal study, I selected students from across class years, with 40% in their first year and then 20% each in their second, third, and fourth years of college. A significant amount of research on college students draws primarily from interviews and surveys from students in their first year. And while this is valuable information, it speaks to the very beginning of a student's journey and perspective in higher education. I sought to widen this perspective with this project and recruited a student population that spanned years of enrollment. I did not limit my investigation to students from a particular racial or ethnic background. 35% identified as white, 14% as African American or Black, 20% as Latinx, 16% as Asian American, and 15% as more than one race. Finally, 48% of the students identified as female, 46% as male, and 6% as gender non-binary and or transgender at the time interviews and fieldwork were taking place. I also spent a significant amount of time hanging out with and following students through their daily lives. I was able to make a visit to each of the campuses where students were attending school, but I spent most of my fieldwork time on 10 of these 18 campuses. From 2016 to 2019, I spent 650 hours with students shadowing their daily lives, accompanying them on and off campus, and working with select student groups around initiatives on their campuses. With the exception of attending classes and spending time in private residence hall rooms, I did nearly everything I could with these students. We drank countless cups of coffee, shared meals in the best college town dives and worst college dining halls, went on grocery shopping trips, stood in endless lines in college offices across the country, attended social and professional events and activities on and off campus, volunteered on service projects, played video games until all hours, and traversed the campuses, towns, and cities they lived in. I supplemented interviews and participant observation with follow-up survey data, self-reported income and outcome data, and data from 12 focus groups conducted with incoming first years and returning students. In addition to collecting student data, I completed in-depth formal interviews with 10 members of the Jack Kent Cook Foundation Higher Education Division staff, a major source of funding for first-generation students nationwide, including a portion of the students who participated in this study. I also included 30 semi-formal interviews with higher education staff and administrators on different campuses included in my study. I sought to include the perspectives of staff at colleges and outside scholarship foundations in this project, as a means for considering the interplay between institutional interventions and individual experiences. This triangulation of data allows me to expand on existing research that overwhelmingly focuses on a single campus context at a particular moment in students' college trajectories. When thinking about the whys and hows of the students I spent time with, it is critical to note that I was a low-income and first-generation college student myself. This matters in terms of both the ways that I approached my research and the kinds of questions that I brought to this project, but also in terms of how I relate to the students in this study. Being a first-generation student that had gone to selective schools gave me an immediate rapport and shared experience with the majority of the students I spent time with. Even though many aspects of our actual experiences in college were likely significantly different, I was also a non-traditional student with a family while I was pursuing my bachelor's degree. We had a common thread that served as the foundation for each relationship I built with a student. I believe this positionality improved my ability to recruit and build rapport with respondents. However, my position as a researcher, who was an advanced graduate student at the beginning of this project and an assistant professor at the end of it, also located me as an outsider who was removed from the stakes associated with campus communities. This positional duality allowed me to occupy an in-between status that I felt minimized bias and produced robust and open dialogue during interviews and fieldwork. Chapter outline. Throughout the chapters of this book, I consider the ways in which the unintended consequences of university programming and initiatives impact first-generation and low-income students, and detail how they navigate the unexpected outcomes of social mobility that accompany attending these selective and highly selective colleges and universities. The chapters of Polished are arranged in a way that traces student experiences across time, aspects of college, and stages of mobility and the polishing process, with each chapter building on the next. I begin Chapter 1 by detailing how selective colleges and universities frame and market the primary purpose, value, and promise of an elite college education. I outline how low-income and first-generation students and their families interpret these narratives, and then select, frame, and prepare for college. I demonstrate that, for the majority of students and their families, attending a selective college is understood as an opportunity to achieve social mobility via a prestigious degree that will lead to a well-paying and meaningful career. Through this, I highlight the ways that families calculate the perceived values of prestige, cost, and distance to inform their decisions around college selection. I demonstrate that while some families frame college and social mobility in relatively uncomplicated and positive ways, a complex framework emerges around social mobility for many first-generation students and their families. For these families, upward mobility can simultaneously be seen as a promise to be pursued and upheld, as well as a threat to be safeguarded against. The mixed frameworks that arise out of this dual perspective of what it means to be educated or become socially mobile produce a variety of responses across families. I explore the variations in the ways that mobility and college are framed across families and detail how different perspectives inform student choices around developing identity strategies as they prepare to enter college. In Chapter 2, I explore the hurdles that first-generation students face during their first year of school and demonstrate how unfamiliarity with institutional structure and social expectations impacts their ability to easily navigate bureaucratic, academic, and social demands. I compare experiences across students and show how access to community resources or prior educational experience with selective schooling produces major advantages for a select group of low-income and first-generation students. Through this, I take up previously explored divides in the low-income student population and argue that further variation should be considered. I then explore how some students assign a privileged status to particular backgrounds and how this notion of privilege is being used to make distinctions within first-generation student populations on some campuses. For readers who are acquainted with the literature on first-generation student experiences and outcomes, this chapter covers some familiar ground, expands on existing research, and builds the empirical and theoretical foundations for the innovative data and arguments found in the chapters that follow. Chapter 3 provides a look at the institutional approach that selective colleges and universities take toward supporting first-generation students on their campuses. I show that the formalization of targeted support and interventions for underrepresented students, what I call the polishing process, has come to supplement and enhance more organic means of capital accumulation that have been the historical focus of many studies. I explore how a focus on enhancing students' social and cultural capital undergirds the majority of programs, resources, and opportunities that target first-generation student populations, and highlight how this work occurs both within selective colleges and universities, as well as through external scholarship and education organizations. I then consider how students perceive and respond to these initiatives, and begin to detail the direct impacts they have on students. In Chapter 4, I explore how the rapid changes that often occur as a result of the social mobility brought on via the polishing process and attending a selective college as a first-generation student are often unexpected, and how this, combined with existing feelings of alienation on campus, can produce moments of crisis. I then focus on what happened.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.